folks, Squid here. I'm going to be watching another instructional video, once again by Sejam. This is entitled Sejam Reads Domination 101 Part 1. You can lead a scrub to water, but you can't make him think. I am still securely in the scrub tier of fighting gameplay. If you watched my last foray into Street Fighter V, I went online and I got into bronze tier. And then I got matched up against a super bronze, promptly got my butt kicked, and I got knocked back down to rookie, won again, went back up into bronze, and that's where we left off. So I think I need to keep educating myself. I have some people helping me along the way. Thank you very much, Dectalon, especially for helping me out and giving me some pointers. I'm homing in on like the character I want to main, as they say. Street Fighter V, I'm looking at Cody. I'm kind of clicking a lot with the way Cody plays. I'm enjoying playing Cody. I think that's the most important part. But anyway, I haven't watched this video before. Domination 101 is apparently one of the Ur texts on being good at fighting games. So let's have a look, you and me.
I will tell you. So the Domination series, those articles are brutal. He eats people up. The Domination series was written almost 20 years ago, from my understanding. So this is the Domination article I always think about. Now, Domination 101 is a series written by Seth Killian. There's at least 8 or 9, right? There's quite a few. These are brutal. And for context of the series, like Infill was saying earlier, apparently at the time, nobody really understood competitive games. And they were like, you know, these are the kind of people that were upset if you threw them. Throwing is cheap. Why are you using fireballs? You're such a bitch. I hate you. Like, you know what I mean? Like, people...
One thing I was doing a lot as Cody was throwing people on wake up as part of my Oki pressure. I just enjoyed throwing people. It was good. And it almost always worked because I guess at this low level of play, people don't really think about throwing so much. And even when they try to throw me as they're waking up, if you know about Street Fighter V, throws offset and no harm, no foul.
Just mad about stupid because this was written so long ago, nobody understood these kinds of things and why they mattered and all that kind of stuff. So Seth wrote this article to target these people who were just morons and had to explain to them, hey, it's a competitive game, you should do whatever you have to do to win. So this is not the first in this article, right? The very first one actually from Domination is this one, I believe. It's on cheapness, but this is the very first one. You can lead a scrub to water, but you can't make them think. What a title, honestly. You know, it's interesting, too, when you watch Seth Killian on camera, he's such a pleasant human. You watch him on camera, he's, like, very well-spoken, he's very thoughtful, you're like, oh, and you read this article, and you're like, what the f***? Even the beginning of this is just brutal, by the way. And it doesn't get nicer the more you read. In a disappointing development, it seems we have a new wave of scrubs announcing they're not only too stupid to play well, but too stupid to even watch a video. That's the first sentence in the article.
Here's you. But he ain't done no nothing I can't do. I'm the next Dern Alex Valle. Yeehaw, a hoedown ensues. This is what people on the internet sound like to Seth Killian. What Cousin Merle means, of course, is that he didn't see any moves he couldn't do. And perhaps, like in...
Oh, Cousin Merle, really?
CVS, not even any combos he couldn't do. Does this sound familiar, by the way? A fighting game player watching a game and not seeing any attacks or not seeing any combos that he can't do. So he thinks to himself, I can just do all of that. Wow, this is a long time ago and it still applies, eh? There's more to the equation, a lot more. Since I'm talking to morons, I'll try and speak clearly. You scrubs watch these videos wrong. You see a match and you sit back and watch it like a sitcom. You're not living it alongside the players trying to think like they do. In real time, you're just soaking it up like the spineless sponge you are. Now, the first identifying mark of the forum scrub, the modern, louder, though thankfully non-scented, descendant of the mall scrub, is that he's not watching to understand. If he did, he would hardly be the scrubs he proves himself to be. He's watching to try and feel cool about himself and maybe try to find some simple trick or combo he can steal. Now mind, this isn't done by getting off their butts and actually doing it. Oh heavens no, insert excuses about money's parents, girlfriend, having a life, just being too cool, etc. But instead, by trying to insert themselves into some random match they saw, who heard...
Alright, so this seems to be about, I don't know if I should say metagame, but like when people watch the videos, they watch matches, they're just looking at the gameplay, the execution, and they're not looking about all the strategery and the mental stuff going on. They can just, you know, gloss over that by assuming that they're in an optimal position to make all the same decisions that the player did. Even though, even I know at this level that, like, it's one thing to watch a match and understand all of the moves being done and why they're being done, and another thing to understand why people are doing it that way. And because, you know, hindsight is 20/20, you can look at a match and see how it turns out and be like, okay, yeah, that's totally how it should have turned out. But when you're actually playing in a match, you're not, you don't know what's coming next.
You, Seth, dude, these people on the forums, man, clearly, can you imagine driving Seth Killian to this point? I can only imagine what he must have read. Because your scrubby motive is to always think the best of yourself rather than understand the truth. That hurt. This works by ingeniously ignoring all the expectations, patterns, psychological advantages, and momentum that the other player had established and just focusing on an isolated incident. Thinking, shucks, I could have DP'd that. I would have anti-aired that jump. This is the special scrubs-only variant of the psychic DP. The hindsight DP? Holy sh**. The hindsight DP is pretty good. But the obvious fact is that you couldn't have. Scrubs at home will be reaching for that bag of excuses right about now again. The armchair DP. Here are a few pointers on how to watch these matches. Now Seth's going to be...
I still have trouble doing the... I know what DP means and I know the input for it, but I still have trouble doing it on command, and execution is something I really have to work on. I am not even at the position where I could be like, I could have DP'd that, because I probably couldn't have.
Be like, all right, you don't want to be a scrub anymore? Here's how you do it. Look for what the players don't do. But how can anything interesting be happening if a whole mess of life ain't disappearing or tain't no huge explosion on the screen? I know this is hard, Merle, but bear with me. Yes, it's important to notice what they do, but a lot of times it's what they don't do. Why aren't they going for the big magnetic Tempest combo with Magneto? I know, it's because they suck. No, there's a lot more to it. He calls him Cletus? Cletus? You don't want to give away any opportunities if you don't have to. In fact, you don't want to give away anything at all. You want to be minimal in all regards. Think of the bad kung fu movies, if this helps. This is a good analogy, I think. You know how that is in every kung fu movie. There's always the guy that comes in and is like, I'm gonna f*** you up, and just like, ah, da, da, and he just starts attacking, and then the guy's just like, psh, psh, and he just dies. He just explodes into a million pieces. There's that guy that rushes the protagonist, and you're like, well, he's dead. Like, you just know it's over, right? You're like, oh, he's dead. Tournaments, even for seasoned pros, are tense environments. As such, you'll often see more mistakes, not less, in actual tournament footage. Yes, that's something that's very...
Mental pressure can be massive, and just, especially when you're being watched, when your every move is being judged by people like this, you know, the scrubs who are saying, I could have DP'd that, you know. You don't want to look incompetent. You don't want to look bad. And, you know, that's intangible. When you're watching a match, that's intangible. It's just showing you what's happening in the fighting game. It's not showing you all of the mental stuff going on in each of the players' heads. You know, you can't really. You can only guess at that or give a, you know, get a post-match interview or something.
True about tournaments and competing in fighting games in general. It's not about not making mistakes, because everybody makes mistakes, right? It's about making as few mistakes as you can. At any level, you're going to have mistakes seep into your play. And in tournaments, people make more mistakes. It's why they tend to be more safe with the decisions they make in some situations, right? You know, when you see someone do like a real simple combo to kill people because they're like, I don't even want to try anything fancy. I don't even want to let myself make a mistake on a tough combo. Another thing outside observers will miss in watching is that these matches matter. For anyone who's never been to a real tournament, and this is very hurtful, and no, getting your 10 friends together at the mall and Xeroxing a flyer doesn't mean you've been to a real tournament. Please sit down. Whew. This is extremely difficult to grasp. They're thinking, what the f***? It's the same game I play all the time, isn't it? Yes, but mostly no. At my first big tournament, I went over an hour-long pre-tournament win streak against all the best players. I was a machine. Then when the tournament rolled around, I swept my way into the final 16 in a 256-man tournament and got wiped by someone I had beaten easily before and beat easily again later. You'll play someone, you lose to them.
Yeah, see, intangibles again, you know. Pressure makes all the difference sometimes. You know, it's easy to sit at home, be a lab monster, or, you know, play an online play against people you don't know, with people you don't have any history with. you know, and do well or whatever. And even if you do poorly, you can just, you know, shrug it off because, you know, hundreds or thousands of dollars are not riding on your decisions. So yeah, it's those intangibles are interesting.
Tournament because you're nervous and you make mistakes, things don't work out, and you'll never see him again. If you blow it, you're out. And the smart mouse kid lives 2,000 miles away. There's no chance for revenge. You can tell yourself it doesn't really matter, but if you're good enough to have a shot at winning in the first place, your guts won't believe you. A lot of people will say, like, I play at my local, I play at all these events, right? We play on stream, it's no problem. Then I played on the stage at X or Y events, and I was so nervous, my hands were shaking. I mean, it could be any level of player, right? World-class players talk about how they still have nerves at tournaments. Back to the loud variety of scrub critics. Here we go. The scrub critics are his favorite people to talk about. How do I know they don't know what they're talking about? They prove it themselves. What's missing from these jackasses is any actual contribution. Here's what you don't get. Pointers on how move X would beat that poke for free, or how so-and-so can't retaliate against this move, so you should shift your offense more towards that, and so on. What you don't get is something worth knowing. Instead, you get the empty opinion of someone who's proving he doesn't understand by speaking in the first place. Whew. Those above the third grand level might realize, hey, I have nothing to say because while not flashy, this is some really solid playing. But instead, the scrub has to convince himself he's a big man by...
I've noticed that I think a lot of the, at least what I'm picking up from here, the kind of the definition of scrub is somebody who, almost like Dunning-Kruger effect, somebody who thinks that they're better than they are, and they do a whole bunch of mental gymnastics to live in this fantasy world where they're the best, and the only reason they're not able to manifest that greatness is because of excuses. So I always understood scrub to just mean like a player of low skill. I know it's pejorative, but this is a little bit more heartening to learn that you kind of have to, just like anything else, you kind of have to earn the title scrub by exhibiting, you know, just kind of, well, for lack of a better term, scrub-like behavior. So I'm trying not to be a scrub. I'm trying to understand my shortcomings as shortcomings, and I'm not going to get better unless I overcome them. It's not a case of I'm going to be a great player under the ideal conditions. I'm going to be I want to be a decent player under my own power, not, you know, when everything just falls my way, because you can't really enjoy that, can you?
Publicly announcing that he's unimpressed. If he were there, he would have won easily. How exactly? No comment. All they can ever offer is empty 2020 hindsight. Does anyone need to be reminded they could probably win if they knew every move their opponent was going to make in advance? Then shut up. You know, one thing that I will say about this as a side note in relation to commentary, one of my biggest pet peeves is when commentators do what is described in this article, which is self-insert and don't understand the stakes of what their opponent.
Yeah, I would never do that as a commentator. When you're commentating, it's not about you. Like, if you have a personality, sure, that personality can come out, but don't commentate on yourself, you know? I mean, people are there, just because people are listening to you doesn't mean they want to listen about you. That makes sense. So, yeah, that would annoy me as well.
Is doing, and why didn't he just do this? Oh man, I would have just done this and I would have just done that, or I don't understand why he didn't just do that. Like, you shouldn't be confused as to why these decisions are being made. There's a lot of stress on the line. It is unsurprising that mistakes will be made, right? It's in fact the opposite. You should expect mistakes to be made, and when people don't make mistakes, you should be like, holy shit, he pieced that together. What in the how in the world did he even hit that under pressure in the clutch? If you're too dumb to appreciate the invaluable resources you're getting handed for free with a little bow on it and cherries on top, at least try and refrain from showing it off. Before you post, take a moment to reflect. Collect yourself, breathe deeply, look in the mirror, and seriously consider, am I a complete fucking moron? Thanks in advance. S-Kill. Oh, man. This is just one of them, by the way. This is just one of the domination articles. So never having read that before, I think vitriolic is probably the most fitting adjective. Absolutely. All the domination articles are...
Yeah, you can tell this is in response to months, probably years of just built up witnessing constant scrub excuses over and over and over again until finally, like Seijin was saying, it's a nice guy in person, but then wrote this article and just had to blow out the lines, you know? It's pretty harsh.
Brutal. He beats people over the head in these articles. But they're very interesting. They're very interesting to read. I played a match at 8 a.m. Evo Pools on stream, by the way. I was exhausted. Like, I had 8 a.m. Evo Pools. I was so tired, and I had to play Street Fighter 4, and it was like my first or second match of the tournament. And I played a guy who was very new, and he only, like, jumped. I didn't have to do anything else, right? But he only jumped, so I anti-aired him to death. But in that set, I didn't hit a single combo. It was like my first tournament match of the day, 8 in the morning. I didn't hit a single link. Like, I could not do a combo when I hit this guy. Like, I was on stage, I couldn't do it. So I had to beat someone in tournament by anti-airing them and whip punishing them, and that was it. I couldn't hit a B&B to save my life. And I recognized it. I was like, dude, I can't do it right now. I couldn't do a combo. I knew it. I was like, all right, I'm not doing a combo. I stopped trying. I would just do the simplest thing I could. I'm just going to anti-air him. I won the match.
I made it out of my pool on Winterside. But sometimes it's like that, right? You're just like, well, I guess I can't do it. And I'm sure somebody was watching that and was like, this guy sucks. He can't hit a B&B. His opponent sucks. He's just jumping and try being an Evo in that environment. That shit's tough. Imagine also being someone who's playing in tournament and just none of your combos work. And all you're thinking in your head is like, I can hit these combos. Why can't I do these combos? You know what I mean?
I do know what you mean, Seijam. There's a lot of times where I'll drop inputs. I want to do something, but my hands can't get the job done, and it doesn't feel good. I feel like I'm really bad, but I'm not even in a high pressure environment, you know. I mean, I'm still learning, but if you're not getting the inputs in, then you're not learning like whether or not what you were trying to do would have been successful. So that's a roadblock that I have to get over.
The combos I hit in my sleep. I play in tournament. I was like, I just don't got them right now. Whatever. This article is pretty brutal, but it brings up a lot of great points. I think the passively watching one is great, and I love my favorite term here, the hindsight DP. I love the hindsight DP. This is a great term. Yeah, this article was a great practice for any Southern D&D character I have to play, eh? Seth Killian showed up with his bolo tie, being Cletus and Merle. It's tough, man. People don't realize when you watch tournament matches how tough it is to do the simplest shit. The easiest B&B of your life becomes your execution-heavy B&B, right? And your execution-heavy B&B becomes impossible. So to train yourself to be good in a tournament environment and do that is extremely tough.
All right. Well, that was Domination 101 Part 1. That was an entertaining article to read, and I really enjoyed Seijam giving his thoughts on it. And I'm not really in the scene, you know, I'm just kind of out here by myself with, you know, several people watching me and a couple people helping me, but I haven't had to, you know, play mind games with anyone. I don't have history with anyone. And well, right now, as you know, the date of this video, I can't go to any local scenes because nobody's going anywhere. So, but it's something to think about, and it looks like being a scrub is kind of a pitfall for inexperienced or poor skilled players to fall into, and it's something to be avoided. So here's hoping. All right, folks, thanks for watching. I'm still streaming 4 days a week over on my Twitch channel, which is down in the description. Please swing by on one of my scheduled days. My schedule's there in the Twitch page. I also tweet when I'm about to go live, and you can watch me learn fighting games and hopefully watch me improve. I don't know how good my pace is relative to anything else. I've been doing that. This is my third week of doing it, like from almost nothing. And next up, I'm going back to the Anime Fighters, Guilty Gear, Dragon Ball Fighters. I'm going to be trying those online pretty soon, a little bit after this recording. So anyway, hope to see you again soon, and take care until then. Bye.